is not like a cat. Meaning, he is not Parichinna nor Savayava. That is Sthanantarana Vyujya, Sthanantara Sanyoga Lakshana Praveshaha. That Vyujya meaning, so separating one place and associating another place, that kind of a pravesha or entry is not possible for Atma. Same thing Anandagiri explains, Niravayava Aparichinnasya Atma. Atma is partless as well as limitless or all pervasive. Sasya Sthanantarena Vyogam Prapya. Perhaps Anandagiri's reading must be Vyogam instead of Vyujya. So Vyogam Prapya Sthanantarena Sanyoga Rakshana Yas Praveshaha. So separating separating one place and associating, or disassociating one place, associating with another place. That kind of a pravesha. Sahasavayave parichandeche marjaradu dust pravesha sadushotyana bhavati iti yojana. It cannot be like the pravesha of a cat. So vidyayati paadu sputayava yojana. Our part is vidya, so that's okay. In short, that kind of an entry also is not possible. So as explanations are offered, the Rakshetra keeps on finding fault with them. Okay, then. Pravesha Shrutya Niravayavatu Asiddhim Shankare. So how do you say that Atma is Niravayava? When Shruti herself says that Atma entered, how can you say is Niravayava or partless? So says, Savayava Eva Pravesha Shravana Kidiche. We say that all right, Atma is part, which part meaning is confined and he also has limbs and whatever is necessary to actually enter. Why is it? Pravesha Sravanat, because it very clearly says that he entered. And therefore, he must be the one who entered, so whatever is required for entry must be there all in him. Then, says Anandagiri, Pravesha Shrutehe Anyata Upapattehe. Since the word pravesha in the Shruti can be explained in a way different from the primary explanation, therefore, bhakshamanatva, later on we are going to say how the entry is not in a primary sense but in a secondary sense. Na evam iti parichinna. This identification is a master stroke of Vedanta everywhere. Everywhere is adhyaroga thinkam. Nobody perhaps seems to imagine that kind. Whoever actually came up with the explanation of identification, really, that is the most wonderful idea that has been introduced here. How a thing can appear to be different from what it is, that's all. Just because a thing appears doesn't mean that it has to be like that. That's all. The idea is like Einstein said, that just because we see this creation doesn't mean that there is all there is. There can be something beyond what we see also. That idea itself will then set a whole chain of thinking that maybe there is something beyond perception. Maybe we can't perceive that. And therefore what we perceive is merely projection of that. He came with the idea, he did not study Vedanta, but then he came with the idea that this creation is a projection. Therefore he calls it relative. And here also that thing that appears need not be real, that mithyatva concept, which of course can be explained only by the prakriya of adhyaropa or identification, is the only explanation for what the Upanishad says and is the only explanation to resolve all the contradictions in life. There is no way that you can ever explain this creation as to why things happen the way they will happen, why is such a thing in the world, why does this sort of no explanation at all, you know. So, explanation is only, who says that it happens? That ultimate answer is only going to be that. Because mithyatva is the only way they can explain the creation and still accept a God, otherwise you cannot accept God. God is nitya shuddha buddha mukta svabhava as suhrudam saram bhutanam. There is no way that God can be like that if the creation is what it is. If he has really created it and the creation is real, there is no way that God can be devoid of or God can be freed from these defects of nirbhunya and vaishamya. No way. Nayayika can keep on explaining, you know, as to how it is. It is karma because of it, the variety is there, because of it, the diversity is there, and God is not responsible. Then God is what kind of a person? Is he a computer or what? Then karma seems to be more powerful than God, you know. therefore no explanation will work. You go round and round and come back to the same hopeless situation. Really, we try to reason with our mind to understand a given thing, and we find an argument and it seems to get resolved. But the mind gets back to 10 minutes to something else, and something else, and something else, and comes back to the same thing. Again we are in the same sad situation. Again I get around to, no, how can it be? Then I give another argument. As long as the thing is given reality, no argument is ever going to explain it. And that is a fact of life. Unfortunate or fortunate fact of life. It is unfortunate for the people who seek explanation. It's fortunate for the people who can dismiss it. What? So let it be. What is the big deal about it? You know? If you can say that, fine. If you cannot say that, I must have an explanation, then for sure you'll go round and round and round with no ever possible ultimate explanation. I can assure you that. And therefore, what will you do? You will never be able to come out of any sadness. If you want to eliminate the sadness or eliminate a problem by reasoning, it will never happen. Swami, this is a way that you seem to escape from everything. Well, that's all. God escapes from everything. In spite of creating this world, He claims to be Suhurgam Sarabhutanam. How do you say that? He claims, I am Bhutanam Suhurdaha. How can it be? How can it be Suhurud? But He says that. The only way you can say is that anything other than Suhurutvam is only Mithya. Otherwise, how can you understand that? Never. That Mithyatma alone you have to understand. Or that would be really understanding the creation, that it is Mithya. Ultimately, it has to happen. Only it can happen when I am relatively resolved in my mind. I can, you know, when things don't matter much to me, when things are all right, then alone I can see that it is Mithya. As long as things matter to me, there is no way that I can see Mithyatvam, for the simple reason that it has mattered to me because I have taken it to be Satya. How can it otherwise, you know, affect me? The fact that it has affected means that it is Satya. But anyway, somehow we inch forward towards Mithya. Slowly and slowly as we go along in the life, hopefully we get released from the Satyatvam or the reality that has been given to this life. That's all, or to the world. Without being indifferent to it, without running away from it, without having pleasure, you know, it's a very Shraddhara Nishita Durasya. It is life, a sworn's edge. If you overdo that, then there is another problem. If you underdo it, then also you have to do it rightly. And that is the sadhanam. Sadhana is, that's what is vichara manga. It gives you no other scope. There is no scope here. Elsewhere you can always absorb yourself, forget yourself, do something. So yoga means all right, forget about it, let me do something here or whatever. Where some kriya is involved, I mean at least you can get some relief. You cannot get any relief at all because you have to face the thing. And therefore you can get crazy with this thing, and that people do. Because it is in front of you all the time. And therefore, you have to keep on resolving, it comes back. You try to resolve, it comes back. Resolve, it comes back and back and back. And as long as you give reality, it will keep on coming back to you. Of course, therefore, we always recommend all other things like puja and all this. It is necessary also to separate from this reality and enter into some other reality, you know, so that at least there is a release. And because of contact with that, our mind gets a little relaxation, little nourishment, and then becomes more capable now of facing it. That's all it is. So, unless you cross a certain threshold, this is not a nourishing thing. It is very nourishing. But unless it nourishes, it is not possible for us to overcome this. And for that, a certain threshold has to be crossed. Therefore, they talk of adhikaritva, meaning a certain preparation of the mind. A person who has crossed the threshold, a person who can be objective, a person who can stand apart. To stand apart from the situation and not get again and again swept in the situation. We stand apart for a moment and again get swept. We stand apart for a moment, again get swept. And that is how the sweeping currents and be more powerful than our ability to stand apart, so long something needs to be done. So what is sought to be achieved through Karma Yoga is this ability to stand apart. Sir, your ship has sunk. What? Your ship has sunk. So what? So it's easier said than done. But this, then alone he is ready for learning truth, not otherwise. It's as simple as that. The truth can be understood only when we have that. How to have that? Then require the grace, then require so karma yoga, worship, everything is there. Even this vichara also constantly helps us. Because when we are in good mood, this is very helpful, you know. And so when we are not, that's why we say, when you are in good mood, then vichara. Not so good mood, Sri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram. These are the two things. When I am in a good mood, this is the best thing. Not in good mood, then pray. So vichara and prayer. These are the two things, and we accept that. It all sounds so nice here. Why? Because in good mood. And therefore, everything is so clear. No problem. We can stand apart and see. Moment we leave this place, when as other things take hold of us, again. Then this very thing, you know, you in fact, this can become such a burden on your head that you can throw away the very same thing because this doesn't help. Again and again you seem to be required or obliged to see the mithyatma when you cannot see that. And therefore this can in fact create such a struggle that you may be in fact, you may be so turned over, burnt out, that's an expression that. You can be burnt out with this. Swami manatau samava gamtu nasi. I don't like to hear this. Why? Every day the same thing doesn't seem to resolve any problem in my life. Never. How are you seeking resolution of your problems? If you are seeking resolution of your problems, that something will happen, then you must do something. Then don't just think. If you want something to happen, do something. If you want to understand something, well then this is there. So Vedanta seeks to resolve problems by understanding. And if understanding is not adequate, and it need not be adequate, we cannot insist that it has to be adequate. In that case, something must be done. Sit down and repeat God's name, or sit down and do the prayers, or remember it. Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu mamanusmarat yudhyache. Well, Lord Krishna knows that so far, anusmaran all the time is not possible, therefore yudhyache. For very anusmaran, yudha, meaning that kartavya is required, or do whatever is necessary. Therefore, as far as we are concerned, there is samuchaya. Samuchaya means samanvaya. There is a, let us say, both of these things go together. An integration, so it becomes an integral yoga. Vedantins don't like integral yoga. They say, this is it, you don't need anything else. But for most people, this is not sufficient. And therefore, integration of other things are required. That's the reason why I do not grudge anything. Well, naturally people require different things. And therefore, otherwise, you're studying Vedanta and still you're going there, and you're doing this, and you're doing that, you know. So actually, theoretically, nothing ever goes with Vedanta. But practically, it goes. For the simple reason that a person needs a certain relief, a relaxation, and a nourishment. If that nourishment doesn't come from here, it has to be sought from something else. But the best way to seek nourishment is from worship of God, that's all. So we would say that, rather than other practices of some meditations and stuff like that, which in my opinion are manipulation, you manipulate something by concentrating, by doing this and stuff like that, you know. So instead of manipulation, seek the help of the one who can help. That's the best. And he is the one who can help. And therefore, seek his help in whichever way you can. And so, you repeat his name, sing his glories, serve him, worship him, do whatever you want, but seek so, seeking anugraha or grace of God. Anyway, coming back to our discussion here, sāvayavahe eva praveśa śravanādi śrutehe Shruti says, alright, when the Shruti says, tat srushtva ata devanu pravishada, so yaha pravishtaha, when it is said then, how the pravesha vakya is to be understood? If pravesha is to be taken, literally, naturally, you have to imagine that the one who entered must be savayava and not otherwise. This is explanation offered by Praveshavadi. Then the Rakshita says, no, it cannot be. Sri Rangi Pravesha Srutehe Anyatha Upapattehe Vakshamanatvat Na Evamidi Pariharati. Pravesha Srutehe Anyatha, we said already, that this Pravesha Shruti can be explained in a different way, and therefore, that's what Vakshamanatvat, which is what is ultimately sought to be conveyed, will be said, Na Evam, therefore. In order to explain Pravesha, it is not necessary for you to imagine that Atma is limited. That Atma remaining limitless, then also we can explain Pravesha in a proper manner. Therefore, there is no need for you to sacrifice the aparichinnatvam of the Atma. So he said, Na divyo khyamutah purushah nishkalam nishkriyam इत्यादिश्रुतिभ्यः सर्वव्यपदेश्य धर्मविशेषः प्रतिषेधश्रुतिभ्यश्च. Two kinds of shrutis are there. One set of shrutis which directly describe Atma as niravayava, and other set of shrutis which deny the avayava in Atma. It amounts to the same thing. But one set of statements of Shruti are which describe Atma as Nirvayava or Aparichchinna. There is another set of Shruti which deny Parichchida in the Atma, meaning the same. But Bhashyakara here mentions both the kinds of Shrutis. Divyo Khyamutah Purushah Sabakhya Bhimtaro Khyajah Aprano Shimana Shubraha Shaksharat Paratah Parah. But anyway, important is Divyah Amurtah Purusham, that's all. Divyah ityanen abhautikatvasya nishedah. Divya, when it is said, he is not bhautika, he is not laukika. Divya means is divine, meaning alaukika. Amurtah, amurtatvam, anandagita is niravayavatvam. And therefore, savayavatvasya nishedah. That when Shruti says amurta, meaning he is formless, meaning doesn't have any limbs or avayava. Purushaha, purushatvam, purnatvam. When it's purna or complete, meaning it's not parichinna, so paricheda nisheda is there in purnatvam, savayatva nisheda is there in amurtatvam, and bhautikatva nisheda is there in divyatvam. So, these ones also deny this kind of limitations in Atma. Nishkalam, nishkriyam, shantam, niravadyam, niranjanam. That is the Shvetashvatara Upanishad says, Atma is Nishkalaha, not Sakalaha, not possessed of the Kalas. He is what? Nishkala. Therefore Bhashyakara says, Purusha is Nishkala by himself, upon him this Kalas are superimposed, and Purusha himself Nishkalaha. Nishkriya, Nishkalam, Nishkriyam, this Tattva is without any parts, Nishkriya meaning without any activities or without any vikara. So by the Shruti, the Savayatvam is denied, the Atma is described as Niravayava. Then footnote number 1, Sarvayati. Neti neti di sarva vyavakriyamana dharma vishesha pratisheda shrutim atra anukulayati sarvayati. Neti neti di in this Upanishad itself, we said more than once, neti neti, not this, not this. Meaning, not such, not naidam, naidam. It's not like this, not like this. It is sarva vyavahriyamana dharma vishesha pratisheda. By that, the Shruti actually does the pratisheda or negation in the Atma of all the vyavahriyamana dharma vishesha. All the dharma visheshas, such as fatness, leanness, tallness, shortness, red, blue, whatever. All the various dharmas or the attributes which can become the object of vyavahara. All such attributes are negated in Atma. Pratisheda shrutim atra anukulayati. That shruti also is anukula. Also concurs with this idea that Atma is not parichinna, Atma is not savayava. So Vashyakara said, sarva vyapadeshya dharma. Vyavadeshamila Vyavakriyamana. Any dharma that can be named Vyapadeshya Dharma. Dharma Vishesha Pratisheda. Dharma Vishesha means particular dharmas which can be named as such and such. Pratisheda Shrutibhyascha. All the dharmas are also denied in Atma. From there also we can say that Atma is devoid of avayava, Atma is devoid of any paricheda. And therefore, if pravesha cannot be of the Atma who is parichinna or savayava, that is not possible. That's not proper. Then another explanation. Says Anandagiri, Adityadau jaladina sannikarshadi sambhavat pratibimbakya pravesha upapattihi atmaitu parasmin asange anavachinne kena chidapi tadabhavat na yathokta pravesha siddhihityaha. Adityadu jaladina sannikarshadi abhava. Aditya, sun, etc. can enter the water. When can it enter? Sannikarsha. Sannikarsha means the contact must be there. Something must be in front of you. Indriya sannikarsha means the contact with the indriya. Then alone an object can be perceived. And similarly also, Aditya or the sun and such other object can as though enter the water when there is sannikarsha, meaning a contact is there between them. So association must be there between Aditya and the water, then alone Aditya can enter the water. So in that illustration also, Aditya and the water, both of them enjoy the same degree of reality, understand? And then alone one being can enter the other. So Aditya dau jaradana sannikarshadi sambhavat. Since Aditya the sun can have sannikarsha association with jala, water, etc., or reflecting medium, pratibimbakya pravesha upapattihi. And therefore, we can say that Aditya can enter the water by way of pratibimba or reflection. That is tenable for Aditya. So that's what the Puru Pakshi says. Pratibimba pravesha vadidhi chet na vastvantarena viprakarsha anupattehe. Pratibimba praveshvadi chet, praveshvadi says, okay, let us say that just as sun enters the pool of water as reflection, so also Atma enters this upadhi as reflection. Why not that way? See, this is pratibimba. Says, na, why na? Says, Atmanidu parasmin asange, Atma is parama, parasmin Atmani. Atma is limitless and asanga. Asanga means unconnected, unassociated. Cannot come in association with anything. For you to get reflected in the mirror also, the face must come in association with the mirror, and then alone the reflection can take place. Who can come in association? The one who can be disassociated. If you can turn your face away, then only you can turn your face towards. So where disassociation is possible, then alone association can be there. Therefore, there can be association of the face with the mirror, because I am otherwise disassociated. And similarly also, if Atma can be disassociated with the upadhi, then you can say he is associated. That formerly he was disassociated, now he is associated. Formerly I was not in front of the mirror, and now I am in front of the mirror, and therefore my face is reflected in the mirror, or I entered the mirror as a reflection, that can be said. But asange anavachinne, Atma is asanga, meaning one who is devoid of this kind of dharma association and disassociation. And anavachinne, one who is all pervasive, not limited. Kena chidapi tat abhavat. Tat means sannikarshadi abhavat. It is not possible that Atma can have this kind of an association, so sannikarsha, contact, association, etc. It cannot be. Na yathokta pravesha siddhi. And therefore, pravesha such as pratibimba is not possible. So once again, na. Na vastvantarena. Viprakarsha anupattehe. See footnote number 2, vastvantarena ityadi. Svabhinna vastuna viyogadi asambhavad ityartha. Taduktam vartike. Sanyogasya viyogasya yasya yeneha vikshate ప్రతిబింబ ప్రవేశోయం తత్రనత్వే యుజ్యతే ఇది. ఐడియా సీమ్స్ టు బి దట్ ఆదిత్య ఇస్ సెపరేటెడ్ ఫ్రమ్ వాటర్, సో ఆర్ నాట్ సెపరేట్ ఐన స్వభిన్న వస్తున వియోగాది అసంభవాది ఇత్యర్థ. వస్తువంతరేణ ఇత్యాది సంయోగశ్చ వియోగశ్చ యస్య యేన ఇహ వీక్షతే ప్రతిబింబ ప్రవేశోయం తత్ర. సో యస్య ఆదిత్యాదే యేన జలేన ఇహ సంయోగశ్చ వియోగశ్చ వీక్షతే, ఆదిత్య కెన్ హ్యావ్ సంయోగ అండ్ వియోగ బోత్ విత్ వాటర్, సో వే దిస్ ఫినామినా ఆఫ్ సంయోగ అండ్ వియోగ ఆర్ పాసిబుల్ దెన్ అలోన్ తత్ర ప్రతిబింబ, దెన్ అలోన్ దిస్ ప్రవేశ ఆఫ్ ద నేచర్ ప్రతిబింబ ఇస్ పాసిబుల్. నదు ఇహ యుజ్యతే సిన్ ఆత్మా కెనాట్ హ్యావ్ సంయోగ ఇన్ ద వియోగ విత్ ఉపాధి, దేర్ఫర్ ప్రవేశ ఎస్ ప్రతిబింబ ఇస్ నాట్ పాసిబుల్. వస్తువంతరేణ విప్రకర్ష అనుపత్తే దై కెనాట్ విప్రకర్ష ఆర్ సెపరేషన్, సో విప్రకర్ష సెపరేషన్ అండ్ అసోసియేషన్ కెనాట్ బి, ఆత్మా కెనాట్ హావ్ దిస్ రిలేషన్షిప్ ఆఫ్ సెపరేషన్ అండ్ అసోసియేషన్ విత్ ఉపాధి, దేర్ఫర్ ఆల్సో ది ప్రవేశ ఆఫ్ దట్ టైప్ ఈస్ నాట్ పాసిబుల్. ఆల్ రైట్, దెన్ యట్ అనదర్ వన్.
తదిదమప్యేతర్హి నామ రూపాభ్యామేవ వ్యాక్రియతే. అసౌ నామాయమిదం రూప ఇతి స ఏష ఇహ ప్రవిష్ట ఆనఖాగ్రేభ్యః యథాక్షురః క్షురధానే వహి తస్యా విశ్వంభరో వా విశ్వంభరకులాయే తన్న పశ్యంతి కృత్స్నో హి సహ ప్రాణన్నేవ ప్రాణో నామ భవతి వదన్వా పశ్యంశ్చక్షుః శృణ్వన్ శ్రోత్రం మన్వానో మనః తాన్యస్యైతాని కర్మ నామాన్యేవ సయోద ఏకైకముపాస్తే న స వేద న కృష్ణో హ్యేషః అత ఏకైకేన భవతి ఆత్మేత్యేవోపాసీత అత్ర హ్యేతే సర్వ ఏకం భవంతి తదేతత్ పదనీయమస్య సర్వస్య యదయమాత్మా. अनेन ह्येतत् सर्वं वेद यथाह वै पदेनानुविन्दे देवम् कीर्तिं श्लोकं विन्दते य एवं वेद Here now is going on a dialogue or a series of arguments between what we may call a Purvapakshina Kshepta, one who questions this idea of Pravesha or entry. How can Parambrahma or Paramatma enter this Upadhi? This very idea is questioned, meaning it is negated. And then we have another person who may be called Ekadeshi, meaning who accepts the Pravesha all right, but not the way in which the Siddhanta is. And there were various tentative explanations of how Pravesha or entry can take place are being offered one by one. And that Akshepta or the Purvapakshi keeps on dismissing each one of them because he finds some fault in that way of thinking. So first question was, how is it possible that this Paramatma enters this Upadhi? He is already all-pervasive, he is already everywhere, and how can he enter? So he is not competent to enter because he is not confined to any one place. The one who is confined to one place can alone enter a place where one is not. And also this Upadhi is not where the Atma is not, he already Atma is there. Therefore, Upadhi also is not fit to become the object of entry. So he is not fit to become a subject of entry, nor is the Upadhi fit to become an object of entry. So how can this Pravesha take place? Then first explanation is Pashana Sarpadivat Dharmantarena. The Atma already is there. He gets transformed as a Jiva, and then that is what we call entry. Not that he is entered, but he is found inside. Not that he was not there and he has come into being. He was there in one form, he is transformed into another form. Just as the clay itself gets transformed into snake, and we say that now there is a snake inside the rock. Although what we call snake now was already there as clay earlier. Or we say that there is water inside the coconut. Similarly also, Atma was there already as Paramatma. He has got transformed now as Jivatma, and therefore he is inside the Upadhi. That is why we say that he has entered. He says, no, this is not right. Tat srishtva tadevanu pravishada. Meaning the Shruti very clearly says that he entered as he was, without undergoing any transformation, he has entered. And therefore, this explanation that he underwent a transformation is not a proper explanation. Then another thing also Shruti says, Tat srishtva tadevanu pravishada. How do you say that the same Atma entered? Because the one who is the Pravishta, one who has entered, is the one who created. Tat srishtva, having created that, tadevanu pravishada, he entered that. So just as they say, bhuktva gacchadeti. Having eaten, he goes. When we have this kind of usage, we know that the person who performed the act of eating is the person who is performing the act of going. And therefore, even though the two actions are different of the eating and going which have taken place at different times, but the one who performed the actions is the same person, the same entity. And here also, srishtva anupravishada, meaning one who created alone entered. And therefore, the subject of creation and entry are one alone. Therefore, no transformation has taken place in between. Maybe that he was in one place and came to another place. Like a cat who is outside enters a house, and so Atma was outside his body, or Upadhi has entered the Upadhi. So such a thing is not possible. Because who can enter? One is Savayava and Parichinna. A cat can enter the house because cat has limbs by which the motion of entry can take place. Parichinna, cat is in one place and not in another place, and then alone entry is possible. But then that kind of an entry is not possible for Atma because he is niravayava and aparichinna. Avayava is not there, so he cannot move from one place to other. aparichana, he is not limited, confined to one place, that he can go to another place where he is not. Then we say that no, we don't care what you say. How do you say he is niravayava? How do you say he is partless? We say that he is a composite entity, that he consists of various parts and limbs. Why? Pravesha Shravana. Rather than dismissing Pravesha because he is niravayava, we say that he is savayava because Pravesha is there. No, one of the two. So, because he is niravayava, there cannot be Pravesha like Vidala. We say there is Pravesha and therefore he is savayava. Then the answer is given. No, again these answers are all given by the Purvapakshi to this tent, to this Ekadeshi. Says no. Which all sound like the answers of Siddhanti. That's why we call him Siddhanti Ekadeshi. But he's not driving it where we would want to drive it. That's only different. That's all. And so, with these arguments, he's driving at something else. That there is no Pravesha. And we would provide the same arguments to drive at the act of Pravesha. That's the only difference. Otherwise, the arguments are the Siddhanti's arguments. So he says, because there is Pravesha, therefore he is Savayava, Vishano, Divyo Himurtah Purusha. We mean he says actually. So that's why. Amurtah Purusha. He is Amurtah, meaning he is formless, partless. Purusha means he is full or complete and therefore all pervasive. So aparichinna. Therefore, Nishkalam, Nishkriyam, Shantam. Nishkala means without kala or the parts. Nishkriya meaning without any activity or without any modifications or without any change. Ityadi Shruti Miha. So the Shruti is very clearly describe Atma as Niravayava, as Aparichinna, as partless, as formless, as limitless, and therefore the pravesha or the entry cannot be like the entry of a cat into a house. Sarva Vyapadesha Vapadesha Dharma Vishesha Pratishedha Shruti Bhyascha. Not only Shruti is directly describing as partless, but then Shruti also dismiss or negate in him any kind of vishesha by saying neti, 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 asthulam, ananu, akhrasvam, madirgham, in this manner. All visheshas are also negated in Atma and therefore also we say that he is nirvishesha. It's okay. Pratibimba praveshvadite. See, one by one so many explanations are there. All right, put it this way then. If you don't like that, okay, let it be this way. Pratibimba praveshvat iti. That the entrance is like the entry of the sun into the pool of water. Why not that way? Then there is no real entry and still entry is there. That sounds very close. Then that fellow says, no, even that also cannot be. Meaning what we call pratibimba or reflection, that kind of thing cannot be a real example. And as a model it's fine. But to say that there is an actual pratibimba, that would be silly, really silly. To confine Atma to any one example, whether it is tenth man or rope and snake, whoever it is, to say that is it would not be right, because then that itself becomes a truth. So that is not so. Yes, reflection is a model that serves greatly to explain a lot of things. But to say that Atma is one shining like the sun, and Maya is different and Atma got reflected, that kind of a thing would not be right. Would be actually childish, you know, to think that way. And so he says, no, pratibimba pravesha vidite, na, that also is not possible. Vastvantarena viprakarsha anupattehe. So, vastvantarena viprakarsha anupattehe. Where there is sanyoga and viyoga possible. Meaning, the sun can be in association with water and sun can also be dissociated from water. That kind of relationship sun has with water and then alone reflection is possible. That water is different from the sun, that water enjoys the same degree of reality as the sun, and the sun and the water can be associated and disassociated and therefore the reflection is possible. Such a thing is not possible. Atma cannot be associated and disassociated with the upadhi. Atma is not something that stands apart from upadhi. And therefore, you cannot say that Atma gets reflected in the upadhi. Now continuing on page 196. Said Adityadav Jaladina Sannikarshadi Sambhavat Pratibimbakya Praveshopupattihi Anagiri said. Adityadav, in cases such as Aditya, which are the images which are reflected, jaladina sannikarshadi sambhavat. Sannikarsha, coming in contact or association. Vyoga means again being disassociated. So where such relationship as association and disassociation is possible, there prathibimbakya pravesha upatrihi, at least that is one of the conditions. Then the medium should be reflective and things like that. So transparent, that's fine. But one of the important conditions for reflection is there must be such thing as association and disassociation. Atmanidu parasminna asange anavachinne kena chidapi tadabhavat. Parasmin atmanidu, however, as far as paramatma is concerned, is asanga, meaning there is no association at all. And anavachinna, meaning is not apart from the upadhi, doesn't stand apart. Na kena chidapi tadabhavat. Atma cannot have that kind of relationship of association and disassociation with anything. Nayatukta pravesha siddhi, and therefore the kind of pravesha, the entrance of sun into the water is not, see, we seem to be in fact cutting the branch on which we are sitting, looks like it, you know. So every time Shankaracharya gives example of in Prashnopanishad and everywhere, jala surya ka adivata, like the jala, like the surya that has entered in the jala. Now he says, no, even that thing also is not accepted. Then prakarantarena pravesham chodayati, all right. Yet another explanation is offered here in the Bhashya. Dravyaiti, says the Bhashya. Dravye guna praveshavadi che na anashritatva nitya paratantrasyaiva ashritasya gunasya dravye pravesha upacharyate natu brahmanah svatantra shravana tatha pravesha upapadyate. Dravye guna praveshavat iti che, all right, let us say that like dravya or the substance, guna or a quality has entered. That's another way. So the whiteness is the quality of this pan. So whiteness has entered this pan. Pan is dravya or the substance, and white is the quality. And so like this quality white which has entered the substance pan, in that manner we may say Atma has entered this body, or Atma has entered this upadhi. Could you take it this way? You know. So these are different kinds of explanations. So far explanations were within the scope of the Shastra. Now explanations are without, you know, Shruti Viruddha explanations are given. Like the relationship between Atma and upadhi is one of between guna and dravya. Why not that way? Atma, the consciousness, is quality of the matter. Put it this way. And so, just as the quality enters the matter or, you know, substance, so also Atma has entered this matter. So, dravye guna praveshavat parasyavi kare praveshaha iti che. So, you may say that even the Paramatma also has entered the karya, suppose you put it this way, na anashratvat guna apekshaya parasya vailakshanyam darshan pariharati. You cannot compare this Paramatma with a quality. If Paramatma enjoys the same kind of qualifications as a quality does, then you can say that he is competent to enter like quality enters a substance. But vailakshanyam, Paramatma is altogether different from gunas. In what way? Na anashritatva. So guna always is ashrita upon dravya. So what is guna? That which is ashraya upon dravya. What is dravya rather? Gunashraya. So what is dravya is gunashraya. That is ashraya, the locus of guna. This is called dravya. That's how substance is defined. So that which becomes a locus of a quality. And therefore, dravya becomes what? Dravya is that which supports, and guna is that which is supported. So guna is that which is ashrita or dependent, and dravya is independent. This is how the Nayayikas look at the relationship between. You would understand it in some way. naturally pain is not always white, it is blue also, black also. So blue, black, white, all of these are naturally not pain. Because blue, black, white obtain independently on the walls and other places also. Therefore there are qualities, and pain is a substance, because pain is also independent of blue, and blue also independent of pain, and therefore they are not one thing. Therefore we say that blue is the quality of pain, naturally. So what's the relationship between them? That pain becomes the locus which supports, which gives ashraya to this quality blue or white or whatever it is. So dravya is ashraya of the guna. But that creates, Vedantins will tear it apart. Such a thing, you know, what do you mean? Ashraya? Can you separate the two? Can there be pain? I mean, what is ultimately the quality of the pain? Painness? Vedantins will go to that point, you know. So we say that guna and the guni, or dharma and the dharmi, quality and substance cannot be looked upon as two separate entities. Therefore we do not accept that duality. That is not the point here. The point here is very simple so far, that the guna is a dependent entity, paramatma is independent, and therefore you cannot compare paramatma with a guna. That's the only point that is made here. Nitya paratantrasyeva ashrayasya gunasya dravye pravesha upachayate. Guna is what? Nitya paratantram. This guna is nitya paratantra. So always dependent, never independent. Dravye pravesha. Suppose you want to call that phenomenon as entry into a dravya, then also guna is that. It is always dependent, and that guna alone can enter dravya, which is independent. Upachayate uchyate natu brahmanah Svatantra Shravana. Brahma is always Svatantra. Therefore, Brahmana Pravesha na Upadyate. That way, Brahma cannot enter, because for Guna, it should be dependent. Brahma is independent. So, cannot enter like Guna enters a substance. Svatantra Shravana Esha Sarveshwara Ityadi. Esha Sarveshwara. Esha Sarvajna, Esha Antaryami. In this way, he is Sarveshwara. So he is Ishvara, or the ruler of everyone. Therefore, he is independent. And the way he is not obliged to enter. The idea is that a guna is obliged because you are dependent. So anything that is dependent is always obliged. He doesn't enter that way. You know, therefore, so it's not that Atma is obliged in that sense, because he is independent. That's the difference. Okay, another nice explanation. Anandagiri continues. Panasadi phale bijasya praveshavat. Panasa means a jackfruit, you know, any fruit which has seeds in there. So, panasadi phale bijasya praveshavat. Like a seed has entered the fruit, you know, put it that way. So, like a seed, some of these arguments appear in Taittiriya Upanishad. Not all of them. This one is there. Like the seed entering the fruit, you know. So there he says, like Devadatta putting his mouth, hand in the mouth, you know, that kind of an entry. But that argument doesn't come here. But here, like a seed which has entered the fruit. The whatever the Swami, that Maharaj remembers at that time, I guess, you know. So different times he may remember, or he's driving at different things at different points. Therefore different kinds of arguments come. He's driving at one thing, that is driving at something else. Therefore different arguments may come. But anyway, phale bijavadi. So it is. Panasadi phale bijasya praveshavata. Like a seed which has entered the fruit, meaning which is found in the fruit. That's why we call it entry. Either one thing is found in something else, that is how you say it is entered. Karye parasya praveshasya. The thing is that seed is cause and fruit is effect. So cause has entered the effect. This is how it is. Seed's entry into fruit is effect, I mean entry of cause into the effect. Similarly, karya meaning in the upadhi, parasya pravesha, that paramatma, the cause has entered this upadhi. Iti shankitva dushayati. And their arguments are more elaborate than they are here. Here the argument is not that. So phala ityadaya, says Vashyakara. Phale bijavaditi che na savayavatva vriddhikshaya संपत्विनाशादे धर्मवत्व प्रसंगार. He says, no, then that Atma would have to be like seed, meaning whatever limitations and its qualifications seed has, all similar qualifications shall have to be there in Atma also. Savayavatva, meaning it's a composite entity. Even seed also is a composite entity. So seed is not one entity, it's a composite entity. Then only it can form within the fruit. The idea is, it's not that seed appears in a day, it also forms. It's also a conglomerate of various atoms, you know, that's how the seed is formed. So seed is, in order for the seed to become the fruit, in order for the cause to become the effect, it is necessary that the cause must be a composite entity. A cause has to, its own elements or the components or ingredients alone grow and then becomes the, like the seed grows into a whole tree, because in the seed itself, those avayavas or the components of the tree are there, and therefore they ultimately grow as tree. Otherwise, the cause must have this savayavatvam, meaning it must be a composite entity made up of various elements or various components, ingredients. Vruddhi, seed must grow into something. Kshaya, ultimately it will also perish. Utpatti, that is a creation. Vinasha, again there is destruction. Dharmavatva prasangat. If you compare Paratma as a seed, then whatever these dharmas are there in the seed, all those dharmas will have to be there in Paratma also, and that is not right. Sri Dhanandagiri, Vinashadidi Adishabdena Anatmatva Anishwaratvadi Grahyate. So vinashatvadi adishabdena, meaning other things, yes, anatmatva will be non-self, anishvaratva will be again dependent, etc. So all these kind of limitations will come there. Prasangasya ishtatvam ashankya says, okay, that sounds good. So dharma vinashadi dharmatva prasangat, such a prasanga or occasion will come. Purvapakshi says, that sounds good. Prasangasya ishtratvam ashankya. All right, why not? Why not Atma also have upatti, vinasha, vruddhi, kshaya, etc., savayatvam, why not? Nachaiti, then it continues, vashya. Nacha evam dharmavatvam brahmanah ajah ajarah ityadi shrutinyaya virodhat. Nacha evam dharmavatvam brahmanah. Brahma cannot be possessed of various dharmas or qualifications like this. What do we say? Ajah, ajarah. So he is ajah, unborn, meaning utpatti, vinash, etc. Not the ajarah, meaning free from decrepitude, meaning free from decay. So we, Brahman is expounded by the scriptures as devoid of any kind of qualification such as utpatti, vinasha, vruddhi, kshaya and what not. And therefore, you cannot imagine Brahma as possessed of such limitations. Therefore, Brahman cannot have entered the upadhi like the seed is found in a fruit. Again, Anandagiri says, Janmadinam dharmanam dharminah bhinnatva abhinnatva sambhavadi nyayah. Anyway, Vartikakara takes up that point of dharma dharmi, no? Vashyakara generally mentions it. Vartikakara seems to take up that point of dharma and dharmi. So Vedantin will ask this question. Is the quality or guna or dharma separate from dharmi, or is it one with dharmi? Is there is bheda or bhinnatvam? So guna and the quality are the bhinna or separate, abhinna or non-separate, or bhinna, abhinna, separate and non-separate. These three possible relationships can be there between guna and dravya. Between dharma and dharmi, these three possible relationships are there, could be there, and none of these would make sense. Says footnote number 8, bhinnatva ityadi. Atyanda bhinnatve na dharma dharmi bhavaha. If the quality and the substance are totally separate from each other, then they cannot enjoy the bhava or the relationship of dharma and the dharmi naturally. If that atyanta bhinna. Yatha ghata patayoho. Just as ghata and pata, which are totally different from each other, one cannot be the attribute of the other. Similarly, if the dravya and its guna are totally separate from each other, then they cannot enjoy the dharma dharmi bhava. Abhinnatve vina. That's where comma should abhinnatve vina. If they are non-separate, then you can't distinguish them, you see. If dharma and dharmini cannot be distinguished from each other, then of course they cannot enjoy the relation, because that in order for the relation to exist, it must be two entities. There cannot be relationship of one with one. Therefore, abhinnata, meaning if both dravya and the guna are one alone, totally one, then also there cannot be relationship of dharma and dharmi. Then, bhinnatva, bhinnatvam, that, no, I think, after that should not be abhinnatva, but bhinnatva, bhinnatva, bhinnatvam cha, ekatra viruddhatvat, asakya bhivagamyam. And you can't say they are one and they are separate. These two things simultaneously cannot be, because they are contradictory to each other. And therefore, what relationship will you arrive at between dharma and the dharmi? Meaning there cannot be relationship, they are one alone. That is all in your mind. That's what Vedantin says. This thing is purely in your mind, that is dharma and the dharmi are separate, or guna and guni are separate. The separation is in the mind, that's all. So duality is in the mind. It's not there. Don't say that you even perceive the duality. To say that I perceive dharma as separate from dharmi, you cannot. But in your own mind you interpret that, that's how you arrive at these two things. Dharma is separate, dharmi is separate. What do you mean separate? Standing separate from each other, then they cannot be related. The one with each other, then they are not two. And then how do you say that? Where is that thing? It's not logical. Logicians themselves talk of things which are not logical, you know. These are of the Nyayikas, talk of things that are not logical. So, janmadinam dharmanam dharminah bhinnatva abhinnatva asambhavad asambhavadi nyayah. That dharma suggests janma. And then buddhi, kshaya, utpatti, vinasha, whatever it is. Or rupa and whatever, guna, all of these. They cannot be bhinna, abhinna or bhinna, abhinna. And therefore, you cannot say that atma has entered upadhi, like a quality enters a substance. Then footnote number 9. Phalabija drishtantasya pashana sarpa drishtantena punaruktimashankyaha. Earlier you said that like a sarpa has entered the pashana, sarpa is found in the pashana. Now you say that bija has entered the fruit, sounds very similar. So they are not two separate things. Sir, Anandagiri gives an explanation here. Bija phalayoho avayava avayavaitvam pashana sarpayoho adhar adheyata iti apunaruktihi. That is the apunarukti you have to see. Bija phalayoho avayava avayavitvam. One is avayava, other is avayavi. So bija is an avayava, is a component, or you know, and fruit is avayavi. That's the relationship. Whereas relationship of pashana and sarpa, what? Adhara and adheya. Pashana is adhara, sarpa is adheya. Whatever you want to call it, anyway. Apunarukti. So actually it sounds very similar, because part of pashana alone became sarpa. And part of fruit alone is seed. But anyway, still you can say that, perhaps better than that would be, that seed is the cause and fruit is the effect. That kind of relationship is there. There again the pashana is the cause and snake is the effect also, but the other way around. However, anyway, these two drishtanta are supposed to be, they convey something separate. Maybe you have to think a little longer about them anyway. Parasya sarva prakara pravesha asambhave. Whatever all possible prakaras are there, all of them are negated now. Parasya sarva prakara pravesha asambhave. Never, in any way, if entry, in no way actually is possible. Pravesha shrutehi alambram vachyam. Alambram means vishaya gati. What is the meaning? What exactly now should we understand this pravesha shruti as? What is the explanation? Alambram vachyam. Or vishaya, what is the vishaya? What is the subject matter, or what is the tatpari of this pravesha shruti? iti ashankya purvapaksham upasamhrati. And so, the purvapaksha. Now the purvapakshi says his paksha. The thing is, so far, first purvapakshi said that, how can you say that Paratma has entered? Then somebody gave explanations with purvapakshi kept on dismissing. Now he says his paksha. What is the paksha? Now this is the purvapaksha.
Anya eva samsare parichinna iha pravishta iti che.
Anya eva anya says footnote number 1. Anya eva ityadi iha shrutau ya jagat pravishat yo jagat pravishat is uktah sa parasmad anya parichinna. We say that purvapakshi says so the creator is separate, already this point has been already dealt with, but anyway, so yaha jagat pravishat iti uktaha, so one who has been said as the creator of this jagat, or rather the enterer of the jagat, saha parasmadanyaha parichinaha, he is separate from the paramatma and is limited, samsari, samsari eva iti yojana. The purupakshi says that it is samsari, meaning atma got transformed as samsari and then entered here. This is how the thing is. He came from outside, or he came from where he was not, he became samsari and entered here. Parichinnasyeva pravesho loke drushtaha, because the one who can enter has to be limited, so atma somehow became limited and entered the upadhi. That is shruti virodha. We would say that shruti virodha. He says, no, this is not shruti virodha or contradiction with shruti. Parasyeva jiva bhavam apannasya praveshavaditvat iti bhavah. That Paramatma alone became a jiva and then entered this upadhi of the body, and this is how, this is what Shruti says. So says the Purvapakshi, so that anya eva samsari parichinnaha iha pravishta iti chet. Okay, so we say anya and samsari. Anya means someone else who is a samsari, and parichinna who is limited, iha pravishta. He has entered this upadhi iti chet. Says Anandagiri, jagatohi paraha srashta iti vedanta maryada or vedanta siddhanta. The parama siddhanta is jagatohi paraha srashta. Number one, that Paramatma alone is the srashta or the creator of the jagat. Srashtayeva cha praveshta. And the one who has created the world alone has entered the world. Pravishya vyakaravana iti pravesha vyakaranayoho ekakartrutva shrutehe. So pravishya vyakaravani hantahamima tisro devata anena jivena atmananu pravishya namrupe vyakaravani iti says footnote number 12. Anena jivena atmananu pravishya namrupe vyakaravani. So, says the para devata, that sat, sadakya devata, that devata who is sat, says this, hanta, imaha, tisro devataha. These three devatas, namely the fire, water and earth which are created, anena jivena atmana anupravishya, nam rupe vyakarvani, that I will enter these three as jiva, and then I will enter them and manifest the names and forms. But the point here is that anupravishya vyakarvane, that is important. Anupravishya, having entered vyakarvane, I will bring into manifestation the names and forms. The idea is that the one who has entered is the one who brings into manifestation the names and forms. So one who has entered, so the enterer and the manifester, both of them are one alone. So says pravishya vyakarvani iti pravesha vyakaranayo ekakartrutva shrutehe. The one who enters is the one who is doing the vyavahara. And who enters? The creator. So that devata aikshata, it is a devata, the creator, who deliberated that I will enter and then I will do the manifestation of name and form. So who is the one who deliberates? The creator. The devata who has created the world deliberated that I will enter. So creator and enterer are the same, and enterer and the jiva are the same. Nama rupe vyakaravani means what? I will then do the vyavahara as nama rupa. So Shruti very clearly says that the one who created the universe is the one who entered, and that's the one who obtains as the name and form. So having identified with different forms, that entity alone has assumed different names and does the vyavahara. This is what the Shruti says. Tasmat parasmat anyasya pravesha na yuktimat. Therefore, pravesha or entry of someone other than Paramatma is na yuktimat, is not in keeping with yukti or the reasoning. It is siddhanta iti na ityadana. This is the siddhanta which is now stated in reply to Purapaksha. Says Vashyakara, na seyam devata aikshata iti arabhya nama rupe vyakarvani iti tasya eva pravesha vyakaran kartrutva shrute. तदेवानुप्राविशदेतमेव सीमानं विदार्य एतया द्वारा प्रापद्यते सर्वाणि रूपाणि विचित्यधीरः नामानि कृत्वा विवदन्यदास्ते त्वं कुमार उतवा कुमारी त्वं जीर्णो दंडेन वंचसि पुरश्चक्रे द्विपदः रूपं रूपं इति च मंत्रवर्णात् न परात् अन्यस्य प्रवेशः. The answer is no. Sayam yam devata aikshata. That very sadakya that devata called sat who created the world, Brahma aikshata, deliberated. Hantaham imaha tisro devataha anena jivena atmana anupravishya nam rupe vyakarvani. I will now enter these three devatas and I will manifest myself as names and forms. Jivena Atmana also it says. But how the Jivena Atmana is explained there is that I will become Jiva, not become, meaning I will assume the Jivatvam in identification with the Nama Rupa, and that is how I will do the Vyavahara as Nama Rupa, meaning I will do Vyavahara as the individual persons. Iti tasyaha eva pravesha vyakarana kartrutva shrudehe. That the devata alone is the kartru, meaning the doer or the agent of pravesha and the vyakarana. One who has entered, that devata alone is the one who obtains now through this name and form. Tatraiva taittiriya shrutim samvadayati. Tatraiva srashtu pravestroho aike pravestroho. Srashtu pravestroho, the aikya between srashta and the pravestra. Tatha tat srashtva tadevanu pravishada. In the same manner also, tat srashtva having created tadevanu pravishada. So creator and enterer are one, that's what the Taittiriya Shruti says. Aitareya Shruti api yathoktamartam upodbalayati dhradayati. The Aitareya Shruti also firms up or confirms this very artha that the creator alone is enterer and he alone is this jiva. Sa etameva simanam vidarya. Saha means that Parameshvara. Etameva simanam vidarya. So having saha srashta etameva simanam kesha vibhaga vasanam vidarya vitva. Sahasrashta in Aitareya Upanishad, that very God of the Creator. Etameva Simanam, this Kesha Vibhaga, you know, this thing, you know, so where there is Kesha Vibhaga, this is Sima. So where the hair parts, so that's Sima. Vidarya, so Bhaga Avasanam Vidarya, having punctured it or opened it. Vitva Prapadyada, having punctured it, then he entered there. The idea is that the creator is the one who entered, that's all. However that mechanism is described, whether he entered from here or where he entered, that's not important. The one who obtains is him, that's the whole idea. The one who obtains as a Nama Rupa or this Jiva is that Paramatma. That is the whole idea. That idea is thought to be conveyed in different ways. Shri Narayana Akhya Mantram Api Atranu Kulayadi Narayana Upanishadiyam, meaning the Purusha Suktam Sarvani Rupani Vichitya Dhiraha. Vichitya means what? Virachaya. Sarvani Rupani Virachaya. Having created all these Rupas, Namani Krutva Abhivadan Yadaste. So, Namani Krutva means what? Identifying with the names, Abhivadan. So now, having created these forms and identifying with the forms, he assumes all the names and now does the Vyavahara as the one who is named. That's all. So, Devadattoham, Yajnadattoham, in this manner. Says footnote number 4, Sarvani Rupani Vichitya Dhiraha Namani Kritva Yad Abhivadan. So Abhivadan Yad Aste. What is Yad? Yad means Yaha Dhiraha. The word Yad should be understood as Yaha Dhiraha Asinaha Abhivadati Yavada. Okay. So Kritva Aste. Namani Kritva Aste. So Yaha, the one actually. So Namani Kritva and Yaha, it doesn't, they don't go together. So anyway, Asinaha Abhivadati. So one who is seated, he speaks. Similarly, so one who has entered is the one who does the Abhivadanam or the Vyavahara. Tvam Kumara Utava Kumari Vakyantra Mudaharati Vanshivitashvata Rupanishad. Very beautiful Vakya. Tvam Kumara Utava Kumari Tvam Jirno Dandena Vanchasi. Tvam Stri Tvam Pumana Tvam Stri Tvam Pumana Tum Kumar Utava Kumare. Says, you are the woman, you are the man, you are the boy, you are the girl. Tum Jino Dandena Vanchasi. You are the one who is trudging along with his stick. And so, Tum Jino Dandena Vanchasi. Shows that the how Namani Kartva Abhivadan Yadaste. Kumaroham. In this, like, you know, I am Kumara, I am Kumari, I am Ruddha. In this manner, all this Vyavahara, who does? Who is the one who is now, you know, who obtained the stri as Puman, as Kumara, as Kumari, as Jirna? Who obtains it? You alone are. So, Namani Kritva Abhivadan. Different rupas are there, identifying with them. He now proclaims himself as all these things, you know. So, it is so sad to take myself to be an old man. It's so nice to claim myself to be an old man. That's the only difference there. It's one thing to act as an old man, it's another thing to be an old man. It's one thing to act as something, it's another thing to be something. Unfortunately, the distinction between being and acting has been lost because of identification. That's all that has been, you know, one has to return back to that, that's all. And then there's no problem. Doesn't matter what that was, whether it is old, what does it matter what acting you are performing? Whether you take the role of a beggar or a rich man, what does it matter? You get the same salary. Or, I mean, after all, it's acting only. A real actor would not have much, but I guess, you know, would not have, he may have something to do with salary, but what role he takes, he may not care. And so, he's so effectively taking all the roles, that, Tvam Stri, Tvam Puman, Tvam Kumara Utava Kumari, Tvam Jino Dandena Vanchasi, Tvam Jato Vishvato Mukha, Jato Bhavasi Vishvato Mukha. You alone are Vishvato Mukha, who alone appear in all these different faces or different forms. That's a mantra from the Shvetashvatara Upanishad. Very beautiful mantra. Atraiva Vakyasheshasya Anugunam Darshayati. In the very same topic, meaning in the same tatparya, that the one who is created is the one who has entered, one who has entered is the one who obtains. Vakyasheshasya Anugunyam Darshayati. Even Brihadaranyaka Upanishad also says the same thing. Purashchakre Dvipadaha, Purashchakre Chatushpadaha, Purashya Pakshim Bhutva, says that in the beginning Puraha Dvipadaha Chakre. In the beginning he created the living being with 2 feet. Puras Chakre Chatushpadaha, and then he created the being with 4 feet, etc. Purasa Pakshim Bhutva, having become a bird, he entered. Meaning there Pakshi, just as a bird enters a nest, so becoming subtle body he entered this. So idea is that he created all these upadhis having 4 feet and 2 feet and what not, and then entered them. So Brihadaranyaka Upanishad also says the same thing. That is the Upadesha in the Madhu Brahmana, where the Dadhichi Rishi, you know, gives Upadesha to Ashwini Kumara. That is the Madhu Brahmana. Rupam rupam pratirupo bhuva agnai yathaiko bhuvanam pravishtah rupam rupam pratirupo bhuva. How one fire, having assumed different forms, has entered this world, and so also same Lord ekastata sarbhutantaratma rupam rupam pratirupo bahischa. And so also the same bhutantaratma, he has assumed different forms, but it still remains bahi. Iti cha mantarvaranat para na parat anyasya praveshah. Udaharat shruti nam tatparima na paradigam. Therefore, based on all this shruti, we can say that the one who has entered is not separate from para, meaning is not a jiva or some transformation has taken place. Paratma alone is entered here. This is a very, very important shruti, because it reveals very beautiful in a dramatic manner the identity between jiva. There cannot be, it's a very dramatic, a chamatkruti is there, that he has entered. Now think, when you saw him, that Saha has entered, and that is Aham. So who was Saha, the creator? Is Aham, the Jiva, that's all. Soham. And so, that is very convincing and very beautiful to dwell upon or contemplate upon, as to how Etameva Srimanam Vidarya, whatever model you like, how he punctured or split open this and entered. Or however, that Paramatma has entered. So the one who obtains as Drashta, Shrota, Mantra, Vijnata, etc., is none other than that Paramatma. This is Siddhanta. Siddhanta is the one who is Srashta, is the Praveshta. And Praveshta is Vyavaharta. This is the Siddhanta. Of course, in that Siddhanta, various questions do arise. Now, Purupakshi is asking questions, okay? So now the Purupakshi is raising different questions. Going to page 198. Parasya praveshe praveshtana mitho bhedat tat abhinnasya tasyavi nanatva prasakrihdi shankate. Parasya praveshe. Now different questions arise. If you say that it is para or para atma has entered, fine. Praveshtana mitho bhedat, number one. Now problem is, now what do you call this jiva? There are many. Praveshtanam mitho bhedat, paraspara bhedat. That all the jivas or all the upadis which you say the Paramatma entered, the upadis are many. And the Atma being identified with upadi also is many now. Doesn't matter who has entered, you know. But then Atma is many. He will say it later, you know. So in the beginning he says, Praveshtanam mitho bhedat. That the upadis in which Atma has entered are many, and Atma is identified with every upadi, therefore we say that Atmas are many. Iti nanatva prasaktihi iti shankate. In this manner, there will be duality or multiplicity in Atma. In shankate pravishta iti, pravishta namiti. Pravishtanam itaretara bhedat para anekatvam iti chet. Pravishtanam itaretara bhedat. Look at footnote number 1. Para anekatvam. Para anekatvam means parasya anekatvam. That Paramatma is multifold now or manifold. Pravishtanam itaretara bhedat, because the upadhi in which he has entered are many, and therefore he also is now multiplied or multifarious. So what is anumanam there? Paraha svagata bhedavan. So what is svagata bheda? That entity is one, but then there are bheda in the limbs or components. Like the tree has flowers and leaves, etc. or this body which is one and all the limbs like hands and legs, this is called Svagata Bheda. So it's not that there are two Atmas, but one Atma alone is divided into many. And therefore all of these Atmas are the Amsha or the various components of that Paramatma. Svagata Bhedavan. So we say that the Paramatma doesn't have Sajatiya Bheda, meaning there is no Atma similar to Paramatma. No Vijatiya Bheda, meaning there is nothing other than Atma which is dissimilar to Atma. But Atma is Svagata Bheda, meaning Atma itself has very, very parts or components, and thus as different parts they enter different upadhis. Imagine that. So Atma has many sparks. Each spark entered this upadhi. That's how Atma is Svagata Bheda. Why do you say Aneka Abhinnatvat? Because he is identified with Aneka or many, or is one with many. Aneka Vaditi. So, like many things, although that there were many, like there are many people entering many houses, you know? So, many people are there entering many houses. Here is one entering many houses, but then that many entering, one entering many houses and many entering many houses are similar in as much as one also should become many somehow to enter many houses, or one should split itself into many to enter into many houses. Therefore, just as many people enter many houses, this one also must have somehow split himself up to enter the many houses. This is the ashaya. Meaning this is a genuine question which needs to be resolved. Now the questions that are taken up are that, alright, suppose based on the Shruti you say that it is Paratma by grammar and stuff like that, Srushtva, Anupravishata and things like that. That's how you emphasize that the one with the creator alone is the one who obtains. It doesn't matter. How do we reconcile our experience? Because we find that jivas are many and jivas are limited. So how do we reconcile that? So reconciliation between what the Shruti says and what our experience is also necessary. And that is now is the subject matter here. Then Anandagiri continues, na parasya anekatvam. The answer is, no, Paramatma is not many again. Egatva Shruti Virodha. Still, you know. So, we are still talking at the legal. Legal means you quote laws, that's all. So, quoting Shruti. Egat, because here the question is of interpretation of Shruti. How to understand the Shruti? Therefore, we are bringing in the different Shrutis to see what is the overall tatpari of the Vedas. Na parasya anekatvam egatva Shruti Virodha. So, Paratma is not many because that accepting him as many will contradict the Shruti which says Atma is one alone. Na ityadana. So, answer is given. Na eko devo bahudha sannivishtah ekasan bahudha vichara Tvamekosi bahunanu pravishtah Eko devas sarva bhuteshu gudah Sarva vyapi sarva bhutantaratma Ityadi shrutibhyah. Says no, because accepting Atma as many will contradict the Shrutis which say that Atma is one. And beautifully the Shrutis are quoted. Eko devaha bahudha sannivishtah. Devata is one, bahudha sannivishtah. Eko devaha, swayam ekaheva devaha, tattat shariresu, tattat sharira anusarena, bahudha avasthitah, bahudha sannivishtah. Although devata is one, just as fire is one, enters many pieces of wood, or enters many pieces of iron and assumes their form, so also Devata is one, has entered many upadhis, Bahudha Sannivishta. In various ways, he obtains in all these upadhis, but Devata is one alone. Ekaha san Bahudha Vichara. Vichara means Vichachara. It should be actually past tense, Vichachara. Ekaha san, even though he is one, Bahudha Vichachara. Ekaha san Ishvara Rupena. Eka evasan bahudha bhutva vichachara vichara vivida charanavan bhavati. Even though Ishvara is one alone, then still bahudha bhutva, as though becoming many, he now obtains Or vichachara means he does the vicharanam, he moves about as many. Tvamekosi bahunanu pravishtaha. So you are one, but bahunanu pravishtaha, who has entered many. Anupravishta means what? Having entered, you are acting as though you know what you entered, meaning you identify with what you entered. Bahun anupravishtaha. Like the fire enters the iron and takes the form of iron. That's called anupravesha. Not only enters, but then he enters and he becomes one with iron, or in keeping with the iron, he also assumes that form, and so also Atma is anupravesha, means what? Entered different upadis and has become one with upadi, equal to or of the same form of as that of the upadi. Eko devah sarvabhuteshu gunah. Also very clearly says, Devata is one who obtains in all the beings. Sarvavyapi, it is not that he is inside. Sarvavyapi, all pervasive. Sarvabhutantaratma, not all pervasive like space, totally different from us. But then Sarvabhutantaratma, the Atma of all the beings. Therefore it is said, Ityadi Shrutibhyah. So all these Shrutis will contradict your contention that Atma became many and entered, or Atma is split into many and entered, or Atma is entered through different parts into different upadis. The Shruti doesn't accept that. Parasya praveshe nanatva prasangam pratyakhyaya. Alright, just because the para is, Paramatma has entered the upadis, doesn't mean that he has become many, and so that occasion having been refuted. Doshantram chodayati. Alright, now another dosha, another kind of a problem that arises when you accept the pravesha in a sense like this, that is questioned here. Pravesha, says Bhashya. Pravesha upapadyate. No upapadyate iti tishthatu. Tavata pravishtanam samsaritvar tadanyatvacha parasya samsaritvam idiche. Alright, pravesha upapadyate. No upapadyate means it is logical or tenable. No upapadyate, not tenable. Okay, you know. So you give iti tishthatu, let it be. Iti tishthatu, footnote number 4. Yena kena api prakarena praveshastu shruti vashad. Alright. Just because Shruti says Atma has entered, so we accept that some way or the other he must have entered. Yena kena api prakarena praveshastu shruti vashad. Shruti avastambena sankshiptaha pravesha prapanchaitavya paschadi tavat shabdad. Later on we will see what exactly this pravesha means. We are not done with it, but we will take it up later on, you know, in this far. But now, let us settle some other points, because even if you explain pravesha, somehow suppose you come up with explanation of pravesha, then also many questions remain. Don't think that you resolve things, you know. Suppose you explain away something with arguments or reasoning, doesn't mean that things get resolved inside, you know. There are in fact many questions that arise subsequently. So here also, upapadyate, namupadyate, it is all right. For the moment we accept. Because Shruti says, alright, pravesha is there in some manner. But even if you accept pravesha, then also so many other questions remain. And therefore, that's it. Now that he wants to take up here. Because you get distracted, you know. If you elaborate too long on pravesha, other questions you will forget. So he wants to settle them. He says, alright, suppose pravesha is there. But then also, tavat pravishtanam samsaritva. See, the fellows who are entered the jivadara of samsari, tat ananyatvacha. So tat ananyat means this Atma who is entered or is identified or one with the samsari. So parasya samsaritvam is said. So it says ananyatvada hetu for samsaritvam of the Atma. This is what footnote number 5 says. Paraha samsari tad avinyatvat tadvadidhi bhava. That's all. So paraha samsari, Paramatma is samsari. Why? Tad abhinnatvat. He is one or identified with or non-separate from jiva. Therefore he is samsari. Tadvada, like samsari. So because he is one with samsari, therefore just as samsari is samsari, so also Paramatma is samsari, because he is identified with samsari. Or Paramatma is samsari because he is identified with jiva, and jiva is a samsari, and so Paramatma, who is identified with jiva, also is a samsari. It is a, so many prasangas come. Again, Tesham samsaritva kim parasya kim ayatam tad ananyatvat, because the jivas are samsari, ayatma is identified with them, so you also become samsari. Again, shrutyavastambhena dushayati. Again, taking, you know, quoting here shruti, again he says, no, this cannot be. So, third footnote. Oh, I see, okay. We have come to footnote 6 and 7. Footnote number 3. Ityaditi aneke tattvata. Yeah, okay. That is a pratyanumanam. Anumanam and pratyanumanam. Aneke tattvata tattvata svagat vedahinaha eka vinnatva eka vaditi pratyanumanam. That's an interesting thing. Vasikara brings up this point. If you say that Atma is many, because he is identified with many, therefore you say Atma is many. Why don't you say many are one because they are identified or one with Atma? Why don't you say it that way? Then also you can say, see, our thinking trend has also become channelized in a certain way or a routine that we think only in a certain way. Why not this way also? And so says, if you say that Atma is many and samsari because they are identified with many, all right. Why don't you say that many are one and a samsari because they are identified? That's what Sukhi.